Mr. Center, how are you?
Good, how are you doing, Mr. Negri?
I'm doing good. So I wanted to tell you a little bit today about the writings of Black Romero Assassins. The conflict that I'm working with is the Spanish Conquest. And Bartolomé de las Casas was the son of a conquistador and who traveled with Columbus on his third voyage to America to receive the lands that he received as an inheritance for his father's labors. So he was one of the first wave of encomenderos that was received a large plot of land, like a huge plot of land, sort of like a, like, I don't know, like a city or a town.
So hence the word encomiendas?
Yes.
Okay.
So an encomendero would receive an encomienda.
Okay.
And legally what it meant was that he would have control over this large plot of land and be at the service of the Indians to bring them into Christianity.
Okay.
And things like that. That was one of the conditions to receive this land, and then also that he paid tribute to the king.
Okay.
The way that actually spelled itself out in real life was that these Spaniards would force the Indians then to go to church and receive baptism and punish them if there was any sign of other religion being practiced, things like that. A lot of times the encomenderos themselves did not understand their own religion well themselves. A lot of times they actually weren't practicing themselves and they just simply wanted to be sure that they got their land. So Las Casas moves into Spain, New Spain, receives a plot of land, I believe, in Cuba. And while he's there, he hears the preaching of a Dominican friar who basically says, you can't be Christian and have slaves. And it eventually convinces Las Casas to try to convert his encomienda into a commune where property would be shared equally and things like that. And it didn't really work out terribly well. So he went back then to Europe. He got ordained as a priest, became a Dominican himself, and began to advocate for this idea that Spain should withdraw from the American territories and should give up this entire project on the grounds of religion, which is kind of interesting. So I look at a couple of his documents, and so one of his documents, the most famous, is called La Brevísima Relación de la Destrucción de las Indias, or the very short relation of the destruction of the Indians. This goes back to early 1500s. So this is one of the earliest documents that takes a critical view of the conquest. And so in it, he gives a lot of details about the abuses of Hernán Cortés and some of the other conquistadors. So for example, he says in Brevísima, says, tenía esta costumbre que cuando iba a hacer guerra a algunos pueblos o provincias, llevaba los ya sojuzgados indios, cuantos podía que hiciesen guerra a los otros, y como no les daba ni de comer a 10 y a 20 mil hombres que llevaba, consentíales que comiesen a los indios que tomaron. So he gives details about the abuse of the Indians, and what that text tells us is that Hernán Cortés had this custom that when he went to make war on some of the towns or provinces, he would take from the already subjugated Indians as many as he could to make war on the others. And since he did not feed the 10 or 20,000 men he was carrying, he allowed them to eat the Indians that they took captive on the way. And so there was in his royal, very sullen butchery of human flesh, where in his presence children were killed and roasted, and man was killed by their hands and feet, which they had for the best morsels. So Las Casas, trying to make Europeans aware of the atrocities that are happening, starts to write in great detail very early on. So he writes actually before the famous Bernal Diaz, who wrote in response to this book, another book called The True Story of New Spain. And he takes a much more pro stance, and he doesn't talk much about the atrocities and things like that. So it's interesting that he ended up having this influence. What's also interesting about him some back and forth in Spain, between Spain and the New World, trying to raise conquistadors' conscience to the fact that like this is not ethical in the slightest way, and then going back to Spain to make them aware of it. It's going back and forth. He starts to develop the theory on how to explain that there's a limit to power, that there's a just limit to power. And he's basing his arguments largely on religion. He's trying to explain that there is within the corpus of Christian and Judaism a belief that might is not made right. And so in another document that he writes, that he wrote, he has this to say. He says, the free national will is the only immediate principle and true origin of the power of kings and princes, and the only effective cause, which to a political theorist is an interesting point, because it's basically social contract. So consent is the thing that empowers a king or a prince. A very modern idea, especially for his time period. He says, it is not less clear that the nation explaining itself freely is the only final cause and object of such a translation of power. But this is not done except to secure the common good. That is, it is never intended to renounce its liberty, nor subject itself to the domination of another, nor that such cessation should impose more responsibilities, taxes, contributions against their will than that which they already had to suffer. So basically, the only reason why people consent to someone else's kingship is because they think they're going to get something out of it, not that they're going to lose something. And so he's trying to make the case that if Spain wants to claim some sort of legitimate authority over these peoples, it has to be through consent, and they're not going to consent if they're not getting something out of it. So he goes on to say that, nor could it do anything that might be capable of producing damage to the common good of the nation. It is not necessary that this should be clarified in expressed words at the time of transfer of such authority to the sovereign, so the people don't necessarily have to say it, because it supposes that it is conformant to the right, to the nature of the principal act, and to the object that the agents propose, which is to seek out their happiness, and it is presupposed that the natural right to conserve their individual liberty, that of their goods, their property, their rights to not suffer without previous consent to the privation of their goods, nor forced contribution of any sort. So with that, he's basically saying that that if the Spanish have to use force in order to gain the cooperation of Indians, that in and of itself shows that their authority is not legitimate. It has to be through consent, and they're only going to consent to people that are getting something out of it. So he goes on further with that. Now, if you crunch that down, you'll find that there are articulations in there that almost word for word that match up with the Declaration of Independence. The idea that, the American colonists, 250 years after he writes this, are feeling oppressed by the British king. And they're basically saying that we only respect you as our king through consent. We have the right to withdraw our consent if we decide that it's not in our favor, we're interfering with our pursuit of happiness. So it's interesting that 250 years before this guy's already talking about this. What's also interesting is that when you compare some of these ideas to the writings of other conquering empires, say Rome or Persia or any of the Chinese dynasties, like that, there's very little that you can find that would ever critique the right to be able to dominate. That almost like as if in history it's expected that the most powerful control. It's expected, and it's almost seen as if that power in and of itself is a right. And so basing himself on religious doctrine, Las Casas is saying, no, there is a limit to power in the interest of justice, that might is not a right. And so I thought that was interesting. These are the documents that come out. So then if I were to define the Hispanic experience of the conquest, I would say it was actually one of cognitive dissonance, that some folks were not feeling good about this. And in fact, I mean, though we don't talk about it much now, this guy, Las Casas, goes back to Spain and engages in this long debate against the idea of colonialism and against the idea of the enslavement and of the Indians and confiscation of their land. He argues against it, and what's interesting is that though he's not necessarily heralded as the winner of that big debate, the king actually promulgated a revised set of laws to govern the Indians, where he forbids slavery and confiscation of property. And interestingly, also around that year, then the Pope in Rome issued a declaration stating that Catholics cannot hold slaves, which is an interesting point. Obviously, history becomes history. A lot of people blew off those conscriptions, but the idea that this guy was infected, I don't think is exactly true. And what we end up seeing is that you can't control an empire across the sea. That's essentially what Spain will find out when they lose control of their lands. So we can dive on there. Thanks for hearing me on that piece.
Yeah.